the most excellent, book I have ever read for, you know, the devil's always at work. We got you, buddy. It is the most excellent book I have ever read. God's got it back. It's the most excellent book I have ever read on rearing children. Nothing can compare with it. And on how to treat your wife. I don't know about that part of it, but how to treat your wife. A Christian director. It's outstanding. The principle of Puritanism is found in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God. You see, the Puritans were deistic, whereas people are manistic. So they're going to go to God first, whatever they do. The Anglican Church, the Church of England, it was managed. For those who are deistic, they're committed to the doctrines of grace. Puritanism was a worldview that was Christocentric, Christ-centered, and theocentric. It's God-centered. It called for a sacrificial pursuit of purity. Conversions were not by me making a call for God. Conversions were by the Holy Spirit. John chapter 3, verses 5 through 8. That's just what God says. So there was a dependence by the Puritans upon the Holy Spirit rather than upon themselves. Their lives so mattered to themselves and God, and they lived them so uncommonly that these nonconformists recognized that the Christianity of their day was an inch deep and 5 miles wide. The frothiness. You see, the Puritans were not, they were a thinking people. They weren't a syrupy, sloganing people. Let go and let God. You let go and you watch and you see what God does. But you don't let go, you hold fast. You like Ruth with Naomi. You cling to Him. You don't ever let go of God. You see, the Puritans believe in Scripture, which declares that man is born fallen. He's born, Ephesians 2:1, he's born dead in his sins and trespasses. Dead. Dead men can't make a decision for God, can they? When you leave him, you go toward the church, you walk through that church wall, y'all. Ask some of those folks to be in that church where you want Jesus. They can answer just as well as anyone can absent the presence of the Holy Spirit. Well, that's what the Puritans taught. Well, you know when the Puritans taught that, you know what they were saying? They were saying, church, you can't make that call. Only God can. And you got to be dependent upon Him. We don't like dependency in the Western world. Not favorable to our disposition. No, we're in control. And so the Puritans, with their stirring intellects, knew that you have to be always increasing or you're falling way behind in holiness. You know, this is a quote from Thomas Watson. A good Christian is not like Hezekiah's son that fell, S-U-N, not like Hezekiah's son that went backwards, nor Joshua's son that stood still, but is always advancing in holiness and increasing with the increase of God. You be perfect, even if you be perfect. Well, Dad, I can't be perfect before I try, but you be more perfect than you are right now. Don't question Scripture. God says you pursue it, don't question it. The Puritanism was a worldview that desired to complete the Reformation. Let's complete what Martin Luther did in 1517 and in 1521. Let's take firms and let's move it into today's world. The Puritans were resilient, whereas the vast majority of the Christians we know are brittle and quick to bend. Y'all, interested in drawing a difference oftentimes between the Old Testament and the New Testament. I always wish we didn't have that white page in between the two. Wish we didn't have a new, I wish we just had a Testament. And it just, when they got to Malachi, they just went to Matthew. You got two M's right there. Oh, just keep on moving. The Puritans, if you were to look at Old Testament, those Old Testament, First Testament Christians, they seem to win battle after battle after battle. Just go with Joshua in the Promised Land. They just beat them again and again and again. Seems like when you get into that Second Testament, it doesn't happen that same way. And when you get into the world today, it really doesn't happen that way. It would appear that the Puritans lost every battle they were in, except they win the last. They win the last 2 minutes of the game. Because we got Revelation. We know where it ends. And they win because they invested unstintingly in the character of God becoming their character, his affect becoming their affect, his personality, their personality. They wanted to be just like him. They believe in the Ephesians 6 warfare in the spiritual realm, but more than that, they believe that warfare was made manifest in our world. And as they looked around, they could see that warfare. They couldn't just see it. They literally. Their commitment so mirrors the heroes in Hebrews 11, those heroes of the faith. It was as though they looked at them and they saw them being stoned and burned and all the things that happened to those Hebrews 11 heroes. And they said, well, if that happened to them, it seems like me, it ought to happen to me. That supplied them an untamed zeal for the glory of Christ. You know, they were a watershed people. They left large wave tsunamis followed them. That's why they were killed. The earth shook under their feet. And why? Because they were uncommon. That's why. And they would not be made common by the culture. Their writing and their preaching was as the sons of thunder. It was as though it came from the angels themselves. It stirred intellect. You know, again and again we see that Jesus taught with authority. And the people were amazed and they asked him to leave their region. How do you put all that together? You don't want Jesus around here? And you know he's authoritative? And nobody else could do the miracle? The blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, and the poor in spirit have the gospel preached to them. That's what he did. That's what they did. They were like living oracles of God. To talk with them would be to enter the gateway into Scripture. They spoke a different language. Y'all remember one time we went to a session meeting here at First Presbyterian Church. I was sitting like by Dr. Connect. He's a moderator because he was senior pastor. And something came up that was most distasteful. Some of the elders forgot just momentarily that they were Southerners. And they started like acting like those who are not Southerners. And I went to stand up. I was an attorney before I was sick. And I went to stand up. I was sitting right by Dr. Connect. He reached over and he put his hand on my leg. I didn't look at him, I just stayed seated. So game over, he and I walked across the parking lot to go to the administration building that used to be out here. And I looked at him, I didn't have to say anything. He said, you know, this is a direct quote, this is the way a Puritan would talk. He said, alas, dear brother. That was the way he introduced me. That wasn't the only time I heard from him, alas, dear brother. I was always with a correct, but it was a sweet correct. I might ask you a brother. I might ask you a brother. The Puritans were effective because they transformed a Laodicean church into a vigorous church. Of the seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3, there's only two that were not persecuted. One was the church in Sardis, spoken in chapter 3. One was the church in Sardis. And you know what? Jesus said, you have a name, you're alive, you are dead. And the other church, Laodicea. Why? Because there was no fervency. There was no fervency. The people there and the people today, they live Monday through Saturday one way and they live Sunday a different way. At least Sunday morning a different way. Y'all, the Lord wants us to be provocateurs of the reformation of all of life, both in our policy and in our practices. Someone has to be the protagonist, almost an antagonist. But someone's got to be the protagonist. Edmund Calamy, and I'll end here. Mr. Calamy said one time, the nature of man is more apt to be guided by example than by precept. May y'all's example go before any precepts, any teachings, any words.